Welcome back to Hot Copy. With us in the studio is attorney Karen Jimeno, spokesperson for the defense in the impeachment trial. Now let's get the side of the prosecution. On the side is spokesperson Congressman Miro Kimbo. Good day to you, Congressman.
Good morning and happy Valentine's, madam.
Happy Valentine's. So I wanted to say yung guwapo at yung maganda from both sides nagtapat on Valentine's Day. No, it's a light moment. All right, Congressman, quick question. What's the effect for the prosecution that you have the PS bank manager saying that the bank documents that the prosecution attached for the subpoena request were fake?
Well, that's a significant information that we found out from PS Bank last night. I think we need to underscore something. What the defense is trying to do now is effectively to say and to cast aside and to be able to set aside all the deposits that have been disclosed and admitted by the PS Bank, as well as even by BI, to be, in a sense, inadmissible because of this disclosure. I think one thing needs to be stressed. The document that we attached precisely was based, as stated in our supplemental motion for the issuance of the subpoena, and precisely we said, very, very categorically, Karen, is that the document that we are in receipt came from an anonymous source.
Yeah.
Secondly, categorically said, we cannot vouch for its authenticity.
Okay, now, Congressman...
In fact, we are not... But needless to say, we said that it is important for us, nonetheless, because it is already circulating, it's already here, it is important for us to be able to subpoena these, of course, subject to the approval. And lo and behold, all these accounts turn out to be genuine.
Yeah. Now, Congressman, you heard Senate President Enrile yesterday give a stern warning. He said, I notice that the prosecution only gathers evidence or uses the subpoena to gather evidence or gathers evidence through the subpoenas. I warn you, it will be fatal on your part. Congressman, I have a simple question on everybody's mind. Yes. Not a lot of people believe the source was anonymous with the bank documents. Why doesn't the prosecution just tell the truth how they obtained the evidence? Because you see, what we're hearing in the trial is so much time with senator judges trying to find out who the leak was. It seems even they don't believe.
Well, I cannot absolutely agree with that, Karen. Because as far as we are concerned, it was given to us anonymously. And the story is, we stick by what Congressman Ray Omani has said. And I think that there is a misfocusing on the part of the Senate, as well as by certain individuals, that we seem to be focusing on this particular matter as to who the source is. Look, PS Bank, in my mind, has every incentive to say that the document is fake. In fact, when she was asked, what is your base for saying it, she never even showed the basis or the comparison because she did not even bring it. But in our minds, they have every incentive or motivation to say that it is fake. Because it could have only come from them. Why? Because the accounts precisely matched. They confirmed it. They confirmed that it is owned by the Chief Justice. Where else could that have come from except from the bank?
Mm-hmm.
Now, as to how it got to us, whether there was a violation on any of the bank secrecy laws, I think whoever is responsible should be prosecuted if in the event it can be proven. And certainly, I think there might have been a violation as to how that got out of the bank. Because the best proof that it came from the bank is that the accounts match. And the accounts speak for large sums of deposits on the part of the Chief Justice. Now, secondly, we need to establish a very important point, is that there was no attempt to mislead. If you read that supplemental motion, we even say that with greatest caution, we say that we cannot vouch for the authenticity. But what will the proceedings be if everybody, as in the public, has due knowledge? It's being talked about by everybody, and then we don't actually open it.
Okay.
And lo and behold, like I said, they actually turned out to be true.
Now, Congressman, I wanted to ask you very quickly, do you feel that the prosecution has enough evidence already to prove your case for Article 2? And if so, will you decide at some point, I mean, as a team strategy, to say, I think we should stop with this accusation and then already hear the defense and then wait for an acquittal or a conviction?
Well, we feel very strongly about Article 2. We've managed to present already evidence just in 2010 alone. In Isal, and he only declared 3.5 million, but we've been able to uncover 31 million in just three bank accounts. And the three condominium properties, including the penthouse that he bought, were never declared except only in April 28th of 2011. For several years, it was never declared. So we're more than confident. But I think it would be unfair to the other prosecutors who have been preparing for their big day, as well as the witnesses who have sacrificed, as well as the lawyers who have made a commitment, if we don't present those other grounds.
All right. On that note, Congressman Miro Kimbo, good luck to you later. And I guess we'll see you at 2 o'clock.
Thank you very much, and good morning.
All right. Okay, so you heard Congressman Miro Kimbo. Finance Secretary Cesar Purisima is watching. Well, Secretary Purisima, thank you for watching Head Start every day. He said, Attorney Jimeno is saying publishing a wrong salin is compliance, form over substance. If this is so, then the salin has no use. Clearly, CJS over 50 million pesos is in unexplained wealth. This clearly makes him unfit to be Chief Justice. Your reaction from Secretary Cesar Purisima?
Well, of course, I don't discount that there should be accountability, and that's the purpose of filing the salin. But here, we're questioning, of course, the due process rights of also the way that the due process rights of the accused is being violated. It's because, you know, the filing of the complaint was a responsibility of the prosecution. They had all the time in the world to clearly state what their case was.
But Karen, can the defense explain why the Chief Justice did not, I mean, 3.5 million in 2010 in the Salin Declaration, and I'm not even thinking that it may have been ill-gotten, huh? I mean, a man of that stature and with their business might have been able to really raise that amount of money, because a lot of people now have 20 million, a lot of people have 30 million. It's not a huge amount for a lot of people, but the question is, why didn't he declare it?
Yes, these are things that will be properly explained when it's time for the defense to present their evidence. I've seen what they will present.
Okay, so he can.
He can explain this. And that's what he's asking for. Let me explain at the proper time when it's time for us to present our evidence. Let's not do this illegally by violating laws such as the Foreign Currency Deposits Act and also getting information without a court order. You know, don't destroy the institution just to rush this process.
All right, questions from Twitter and Facebook for you. This is going to be a lot, so you have to answer fast. Ramboy Lukman asks, how is it to be surrounded by veteran lawyers in the team?
Well, it's been an honor and a great learning experience, especially just watching Justice Cuevas.
I have to say,
court.
Me too. Yeah.
He's really
even
brilliant.
The prosecution will admit to that. Yeah.
Yeah, and for me, I don't think I can compare to anyone there. So just being around them for me is a big, big learning experience.
Okay, Alex Limpin Galban Jr. asks, what can you say about the graded recitation involving Senator Miriam and Congressman Tupas? Some people found that a bit humiliating and unnecessary.
Well, I don't think that was the intention of Senator Santiago. You know, they're both from Iloilo. I don't think there's any intention to embarrass. But I think what she's trying
to do... But they're rivals in Iloilo. Okay, go ahead.
I think it's more of pointing out to the prosecution why this trial is taking longer than it should. Because the shortcomings are from the lack of preparation on the prosecution. And I think that's what she's trying to point out here.
Al Kagalingan asks, do you really believe with all your heart that what you are doing as spokesman for Corona is morally right and that your client is truly innocent and still deserves to be Chief Justice?
Well, you know, doing something morally right has nothing to do with determining, yes, I know that I can vouch that he's innocent. It's really, I mean, in this, I mean, I'm here because I know that there's an explanation for everything, but you also have to know that you should be upholding the rule of law, and that's what we're trying to do here. Even a guilty person deserves their day in court, but here we don't even know that he's guilty. Mm-hmm. Everything is based on suspicion.
But what's ironic with you is you signed a petition in UP.
Yes.
UP had a manifesto back in 2010, opposing the appointment of Corona as Chief Justice by former President Arroyo, and you signed that manifesto.
Yes.
Hindi pa pagbaliktad yon sa pinanindigan mo?
No, this is really consistent sa pinapanindigan ko. Sa akin kasi, this should really, you always have to uphold the rule of law. And in this case, I had my own interpretation of that constitutional provision on midnight appointments.
Yes.
So I voiced it out. I was exercising my right to freedom of expression. But then, these are the instances where your own opinion of what the law provides is not the same as the decisions of the Supreme Court. And this always happens to litigants. That's why you have two sides always fighting.
Yeah, but what made you turn?
It's not, I haven't turned. It's still okay. My own interpretation. If I become Justice of the Supreme Court one day, I may be one of those dissenting opinions if the majority still says that that's the correct interpretation. But my point is, the Supreme Court, if they come out with a decision, and this is a decision of the majority, okay, not even by Chief Justice Corona, then that becomes part of the law of the land, and we have to follow and uphold it, just like when the legislature comes out with laws.
But accepting his appointment, the midnight appointment, is one of the articles of impeachment.
Yes.
I mean, it's there.
Exactly.
How
then
would
that's
you defend
my,
that?
Yeah, no, that's exactly my point. You have a Supreme Court decision. After I signed the manifesto, the Supreme Court decision came out. You have a Supreme Court decision
saying
that this is legal.
So you
accept
it. So
in my point, no, you can't impeach a person on if that's consistent with the rule of law, in my point.
Yeah.
You have to always uphold the rule of law. So if you're saying that there's a Supreme Court decision that becomes part of the law of the land that upholds the legality of that appointment, then in my point of view, you can't impeach a person whose appointment has already been upheld as legal.
Okay. All right. You made that clear. You said, in effect, when the Supreme Court made a decision, you respect that the Supreme Court has said it was legal.
Yes.
Okay. Riza DF asks, how do you manage to look fresh, calm day in and day out? I want to have whatever she's having. Well, she's newly married. That's one.
Yeah, maybe. I don't even think I look fresh. I'm already starting to feel the stress from.
There's a running joke. You could be an FHM.
No.
or Binibining Pilipinas. Somebody tweeted it.
I know that's overestimating. I think my looks. I don't believe that's it.
All right. John Poggy asks, would you consider hosting a show?
No, I think my competence is being a lawyer, and I don't know, it's just not, I don't see myself doing that.
No, but you know, we have to tell the public, this isn't just beauty, huh? You graduated from Harvard, didn't you?
Yes.
Yeah, what specifically, I read it somewhere, it was a double course?
No, it's a master's in law, master of laws course.
Uh-uh.
I just did classes in Harvard Kennedy School and Harvard Business School, but the degree itself is just in law.
I see. Yeah. So it's beauty and brains. Where did you meet your husband? It's Valentine's. You have to indulge me.
We met here in the Philippines during one of his visits to the Philippines, and we were introduced. But at that time, he was always flying in and out because he's not from here.
How long were you dating before you got married?
Let's see. I even forget. Maybe about three years. It's already 2012, right? Yeah. Yep.
Yeah, now people have been asking, how old are you?
31.
31, that's very young.
I was going to say, old at least,
no,
relatively old.
Not at all. So are you going to plan to have your first baby soon?
I think my mom was planning me having a baby very, very soon. That's why she was very upset when I agreed to be spokesperson, because she was hoping as soon as I got married that then we're going to try for a baby, because she wants a grandchild very
bad. Now, do you have family that's anti-corona that's telling you, Karen, why did you do this? Why did you take it?
Not really. No, they're neutral. So it's not like they were pro-corona as well, because we had no personal affiliation with corona. So it was more of a concern, because when this case started, it was publicly, you know, made known that he had negative approval ratings. So my mom was very concerned, and she kept telling me, do you really know what you're getting into? You know, usually, even if they say don't shoot the messenger,
yes,
it still happens.
Now, clearly, you know, you have newfound popularity. Celso Pamintuan says, ang ganda ni Karen J, kaya lang nasa wrong side siya.
Well, I still respect, you know, different views. And if he thinks we're on the wrong side, that's fine. I just hope that he still respects, of course, the the law and the process. So maybe in the end, if we see all the evidence, then we can prove him wrong.
Now, would the defense want to present their evidence on Article 2 already, or you'd prefer to wait it out until the end?
Well, of course, following the rules of impeachment, we were ready to just present all our evidence after the prosecution presents all their evidence. Mm-hmm. But of course, one of our concerns now is that this is not a regular trial. This is a trial by publicity as well, it seems. And then the problem is every time new evidence comes out, the prosecution is able to discuss this in public and in the process put the Chief Justice in a bad light. So, but you can't really speak out and start
explaining.
But would
you want that? Would you want to present right after? That was Senator Recto's proposal.
Yeah, I think, you know, we should look into the merits of doing that.
Okay.
Because then we can start answering this question about the bank accounts, the sell-in.
All right. I didn't mean to cut you there.
No, I understand.
We don't have enough time.
Yes.
But Attorney Karen, thank you for coming.
You so
and
much.
Happy Valentine's Day
thank
to you.
You. It's an honor to meet you in person.
Thank you. It's likewise. All right. That's Head Start today. I'm Karen Davila. Have a sweet Valentine's, everyone. Oh, by the way, not only is it Valentine's Day, it is also the birthday of Senate President Juan Ponce Enrile. I would give anything to be that sharp at 88 years old. I'll see you again tomorrow, everyone. Impeachment hearing, 2 o'clock this afternoon. I'll see you at 1 on ANC.